The Depression was caused by government. It was a result of bad government. It was a result of government actions not working the way they were intended to. The Federal Reserve System was established in 1914 for the purpose of preventing things like the Great Depression. And yet, its existence was responsible, in my opinion, for the depth of the Depression. So that you cannot look at the after effect without looking at what came before. Given that you made the terrible mistakes that led to the Great Depression, I have never criticized the remedial actions that were taken immediately thereafter to help the people who were so badly hurt. That was a desirable thing, and it was a reaction to it. The bad things about the New Deal were not those. The bad things about the New Deal was not the Works Progress Administration, which offered temporary jobs, the Civilian Conservation Corps. That was not the bad things. Those were good things. The bad things about the New Deal were the more permanent changes it introduced in the institutions of the country. One of them has recently come home to roost in the Federal Savings and Loan Insurance Corporation. That's a strict New Deal consequence. That was established why was it established? If a private organization makes a mistake, does things badly, it will lose money and it will have to go out of business. If a public organization does things badly, and governmental organization does things badly and makes bad mistakes, it will be expanded. It will be expanded because they'll say, well, it's all because we just didn't have enough resources to it. Or else, it will be left to stand, and another organization will be set up to do what it was supposed to do. That is this case. The Federal Reserve System was established to prevent the bank runs and bank failures that happened during the Great Depression. But they made it worse, much worse, by not doing what they were setting up to do. They were supposed to provide liquidity, and instead they reduced liquidity. The quantity of money in the United States fell by a third between 1929 and 1933. The Federal Reserve System at all times during that period had the power to prevent that decline. And it was established for the purpose of preventing that from happening. It didn't do it. And so what happened? The Federal Reserve System wasn't abolished, unfortunately. But the Federal Deposit Insurance was created to do what the Federal Reserve System had been supposed to do, to prevent bank runs. I have never argued that government initiatives may not be just as good as private initiatives. The problem with government is not in the things it tries, but in the absence of any mechanism for recognizing error. What the private system abounds in is survival of the fittest. What the governmental system abounds in is expansion of the mistakes. And there's no mechanism for eliminating governmental agencies which either have no longer are needed or have behaved perversely. If you try to think back and ask yourself, how many government agencies can you think of that have ever been abolished? You could count those on the fingers of one hand. One of the government agencies that was abolished was, there once existed a system of postal savings where the post offices held savings. How come it became abolished? Because when it was passed, the law was passed, it was passed that it could not pay, that it was limited to paying interest of a maximum of 2%. Now, during the Great Depression, that was wonderful because it was safe. And postal savings deposits expanded and became very large. During the later 30s, and particularly after the war, when interest rates started going up way above 2%, everybody took their money out of the postal savings. There was no more money in there and it was allowed to die. Now, that's one of the very few examples of a government agency that has been eliminated. Can you name any others? Now, we don't have a free market, don't kid yourself. And the biggest enemies of a free market, the two biggest enemies of the free market are two separate groups, my academic colleagues and business people. Their business people are enemies of free markets, not friends. The academic people are all in favor of freedom for themselves, except even now they aren't even in favor of that with this politically correct nonsense that's going around. But historically, academic people have always been in favor of freedom for themselves. They want to be able to say what they want, write what they want, do whatever research they want. But they're all against freedom for everybody else. They think that they know better what's good for the poor people than the poor people do. They think they can run the economy better than the businesses can. The business people are just the opposite. They're all in favor of freedom for everybody else. And at the drop of a hat, you can get any leading businessman to give you an eloquent speech on the virtues of free market. But when it comes to their own business, they want to go down to Washington and get a special tariff to protect their business. They want a special tax deduction. They want a tax subsidy. When Chrysler's on the verge of failing, which it should have done, it should have been allowed to fail, Chrysler goes down and exercises political influence to try to get the government to lend it money to subsidize. So businessmen in general, not all, there have been some notable exceptions, and I don't want to include everybody, just as not all intellectuals are in that class. But in the main, most businessmen are enemies of free markets. The real beneficiaries of free markets are the invisible man, the consumer, the ordinary worker. Those are the real people who benefit from free markets, but unfortunately, they don't have the kind of political clout that PAC, Political Action Committee from big business has. One of the great economists of the 19th century was Alfred Marshall. And he has as a sort of motto for one of his books, the seen and the unseen. And it's a marvelous motto for this. What happens in economics over and over again is that there are two sets of effects of any action. The immediately visible effects and the widespread invisible effects. And the widespread invisible effects are often much more important than the visible ones. But people don't see them. Let me give you very simple examples. We have a quota on the amount of sugar that can be imported from various countries. The visible effect of that is that there are about a couple hundred thousand growers of beet sugar who benefit greatly from it, who are able to keep on growing beet sugar. They don't benefit so greatly because most of the money goes into paying the expenses of growing the beets. And indeed, if there were no such quota, they would find something else to do. But who believe, in the short run, appear, the visible effect is that they are able to have a market they would otherwise not have. The invisible effect is that every consumer in the United States pays twice as much for the sugar he or she buys as the world price. Now, you're a consumer. How much attention to the fact do you pay to the fact that you pay twice as much for sugar as you ought to? Is the fact that you pay twice as much for sugar as you ought to going to lead you to go down to Washington to testify against the sugar quota? But are the beet sugar farmers going to go down to Washington to testify in favor of the sugar quota? It's a typical example of the seen versus the unseen, the concentrated visible versus the dispersed invisible. And the major reason why roughly half the income of this country is controlled by governmental agencies instead of by the people who earn it is because of this contrast between the visible and the invisible. We talk about this, about a majority government. It is a majority government, but it's a very funny kind of a majority. It's a majority made up of a whole bunch of minorities. You've got 0.1% of the people who are beet sugar growers. They're part of this majority. You've got another 0.2%, 1 or 2% of the people who are in the textile industry. And they make us pay twice the world price for shirts and for other things because of textile tariffs and textile agreement around the world. And so down the line, you got all these special interests, you got labor unions, you got these and those. Each one separately is a little minority, but they all get together. Each minority is more interested in its own little problem than in what happens for the rest of the country, and so it's willing to give its vote to the other things. If they'll give it, it's a case of log rolling. So what we have is a log rolling majority in which the majority of the people are not, in fact, represented. Is there any doubt in your mind? Suppose you were able to get an effective poll from the people at large on this question. The government imposes quotas on the import of sugar. The result of that is that X thousand farmers are able to grow beet sugar who otherwise would not, and that you are paying twice the world price for sugar. Are you in favor of this? Is there any doubt to you in your mind that a majority would say they're opposed to? Let me give you another example, which is much more important and much more dramatic. Of course, the most socialized industry in the United States is the military. But next to the military, the most socialized industry in the United States is schooling. 9 out of 10 of youngsters, leave for a moment the colleges and universities aside, although it's true for them too. But let's stick to elementary and secondary schooling. Everybody recognizes that over the course of decades, the amount of money that's going into that in real terms after adjustment for inflation has been going up per student very sharply. And everybody recognizes that the quality of education has been going down. There's not the slightest doubt. All socialist enterprises are the same. If you take them in Europe, whether you take them in Russia, in Poland, in Czechoslovakia, or in the United States, socialized enterprises produce poor quality products at high prices but confer special benefits on small groups. That's the characteristic. One proposal for privatizing education, for improving it, is one that I made first some over 30 years ago in a book that I was published, well, it was in an article first, and then in a book that was published just about 30 years ago, is a voucher system, which has been gotten a lot of attention, which is simply the idea that parents should be able to decide what school their children go to. That what you should do is to say to every parent, if you send your child to a public school, to a government school, it's costing the taxpayer now roughly about $4,000 to $5,000 per student. So if you decide to send them to any other kind of a school, we'll give you a voucher worth $3,000 so we can make some money out of it too, let's say, just for an example, by which you can choose any school you want, governmental, private, nonprofit, profit-making, Catholic, Jewish, Protestant, whatever, any school you want. The parents should have the choice. Those of us who are in the upper income classes have that choice now because we can afford to pay twice for schooling, once through taxes and once directly through tuition. The people who are hurt by the present system are the poor people. And the people who are hurt worst are those in the inner cities who cannot get a decent education for their children. Now, the voucher system, there have been some, quite a large number of public opinion polls about how people feel toward various proposals, including the voucher system. In every poll that has been taken, the group which gives the largest majority in favor of the voucher system are the blacks. The blacks vote 2-1 in favor of the voucher system. There is not a single black leader who has come out in favor of the voucher system. I once tried to persuade Jesse Jackson. I happened to be riding on a private plane with him from somewhere to Washington, I've forgotten from where, and I got him started on it. He acted as if he had never heard of the idea, but of course he had. Oh, it's a wonderful, splendid idea. Where do you send your own children? Well, several of them are going to private schools, of course. At any rate, you never heard another word from Jesse Jackson in favor of the voucher system. Why? Because where do the black leaders get their political clout? From being able to appoint people to school boards, from being able to get jobs in the school system for some of their people. They can get support out of the voters by voting for more money for education. But if once a voucher system were adopted, they would no longer have any political clout. And that is why every attempt to get a voucher system, and there have been many of them, has been destroyed and frustrated by the people with a vested interest in not having it, in particular the officials of the teachers' trade unions, of the state employees' unions, and the political people like Jesse Jackson and other such political leaders. But the reason I cite this example, and I think it's so dramatic, is because of the unwillingness of the black leaders to support something of which the major beneficiaries would be the people they're supposedly representing. There's a pot of money there in every one of these cases. And just as bees will go to honey, people will go to a pot of money. And the people who will be most effective in getting control of that pot of money are people who are trying to grab it for themselves rather than people who are trying to spend it on behalf of somebody else. Everybody wants to spend somebody else's money. And nobody spends somebody else's money as carefully as he spends his own. That's a fundamental principle. There's only one way, in my opinion, in which you can exercise control over this process. And that's by effective constitutional limitation backed by public opinion. If it's not backed by public opinion, it will do no good. We have free speech because of the First Amendment of the Constitution. I would be, in our book, Free to Choose, we listed the amendments we would like to see in the Constitution. They're much broader than that. Such as that Congress shall make no laws prohibiting any trades between consenting individuals with respect to goods that it's legal to trade. Now, that would eliminate all tariffs, it would eliminate the sugar quota. That you may not see offhand that it would, but it would if you think about it a little, because individuals include foreign individuals and not only domestic individuals. So no, I would really like much broader constitutional limitations than just a limitation and there are many other things you can think of. For example, you might have a constitutional amendment that nobody can be elected to Congress and Senate unless he's more than 60 years of age. That would eliminate the possibility of people being elected to Congress in order to be able to get benefits after they leave Congress. You see, that's the defect. I happen to be in favor of term limitation proposals simply because maybe that's a possible thing you can get. But the defect of term limitation proposals is you have young people who enter Congress and they're limited to 12 years. They'll use those 12 years to get brownie points with people on the outside who'll give them a job later. So it'd be much more effective to limit the legislature to people or to make it a part-time job or an unpaid job. Anyway, there are lots of solutions. I'm not going to go through the solutions here. Our books, Free to Choose, and Earlier One, Capitalism and Freedom, are much better from that point of view than what I can say here. But what I will say, you will not solve these problems by taking them up on a one-by-one basis. You will never get rid of the sugar quotas by having sugar consumers testify against them. You might get a constitutional amendment that there shall be no tariffs or other interferences with foreign trade, which lumps everything together so people can see that they have a real interest in it. But if you try to do it piece by piece, you'll get killed every time. I would like to get rid of the Federal Reserve, too. I would like to have money controlled by a computer. However, that's not what's happening, and I'm a realist. You're going to have a Federal Reserve system, and therefore it's relevant to ask, given that there is a Federal Reserve system, even though it'd be a better world if we could get rid of them, how should Federal Reserve operate? So I've been concerned with monetary policy by trying to see how to make it less harmful than it is likely to be. I don't want to say that government, it's necessary. There are certain things that it is essential for government to do. I'm not an anarchist. I believe in a government, but a limited government. And the government should be limited, in my opinion, to very simple functions. Number one, to defending the country against foreign enemies. I have tried for a long time to see how to make national defense a private enterprise, and I have never succeeded. It's easy to see how to privatize schooling, but I don't know how to privatize national defense. So I'm reconciled to the fact that we're going to have to pay twice as much as we should have to pay in order to get an effective national defense. Because anything government does, on the average, there's some things that are more, some less. On the average, anything government does costs twice as much as if it were being done by private enterprise. So one function of government is to protect the country against foreign enemies, national defense. A second function of government, and one which it performs very, very badly, is to protect the individual citizen against abuse and coercion by other citizens. To keep you from being hit over the head, mugged on the street, your house broken into, and so on. And I believe that the government performs that function very ineffectively because it's doing so many things it has no business doing. A third function of government, a very important function, is to define the rules of the game we play. What's private property? If an airplane flies 10,000 feet over your house, is he violating your private property? If he flies 10 feet over your house, is he violating your private property? There's nothing natural about where the line should be drawn. So we have to have some mechanism for making the rules about that, and that is an appropriate government function. And fourth, it's appropriate for government to provide a mechanism for adjudicating disputes about the meaning of those rules, a judicial system. Those are the four essential functions of government, in my opinion, and those are the only functions that are essential. There may be some other areas in which, if you started with nothing more than that, government might conceivably do more good than harm. But from where you are now, if you could only move back in that direction, it'd be marvelous. There's no way you're going to do it. The best you can hope for is that you can hold down government, keep it where it is, and let the private economy expand so that government becomes a smaller and smaller fraction of it. And even that is a very optimistic expectation, though it's possible. But going back to monetary policy, what is monetary policy concerned with? It's concerned fundamentally with what happens to the quantity of money. What's money? There's no natural definition of money. The first thing, money is whatever you use to engage in transactions, whatever it is that people are willing to accept, not because they want it, but because they know that somebody else will accept it in return for something they want. And you know, in the history of the world, you can hardly name a commodity that has not been used as money at one time or another. There's an island in the Pacific which uses great big stones as money, the island of Yap. There are parts of Africa and India which for many centuries used cowrie shells, little shells that you pick up on the beach, as money. The colonies, Virginia and North Carolina and so on, those southern colony group colonies, for many years used tobacco as money. But of course, the thing that has mostly been used as money historically have been silver and gold as metals. But we've gotten beyond that, and now we use pieces of paper as money. The pieces of paper in your pocket, the equivalent of those, the deposits you have in your bank on which you think you can write checks and other people will accept your checks, or you can go down to an ATM and withdraw some cash. So that the sum of the paper you carry around in your pocket and in one or another class of deposits, and there are very different classes, is money. And the question is, who determines how much money there is? And the answer is, in our present system, there are 19 people who sit around a table in Washington once every 2 weeks who have the power, the unlimited power, to double the quantity of money over the next year or to cut it in half over the next year. Those 19 people are the 7 members of the Federal Reserve Board and the 12 presidents of the Federal Reserve Banks, of the regional Federal Reserve Banks. Only 5 of those 12 presidents have a vote on that open market committee at any time, but all 12 attend every meeting and influence the action that occurs. They have the unquestioned power to do this. And it was the way they exercised that power during the Great Depression that was responsible for the depth of the Depression. It was the way they exercised that power during the 1970s that was responsible for the inflation during the 1970s. And is fundamentally responsible for the savings and loan debacle. So how they exercise that power makes an enormous amount of difference. And in my opinion, I shouldn't say opinion, because I have spent much of my life studying this. I've written or co-authored a series of books dealing with a major book dealing with the monetary history of the United States and others. So this is an opinion, but it's an informed opinion that is based on some evidence and work. The Federal Reserve, over the whole of its existence, has done much more harm than good. Yet, I want to give a tribute to Alan Greenspan, the present chairman of the Federal Reserve. As penance for my sins, I have read the statement of every chairman of the Federal Reserve Board since its beginning to Congress, when he reports to Congress. I hate to tell you how many of those I've read. Until Alan Greenspan alone, in not a single one of those did any chairman ever say, we may have made a mistake. Every one of those reports, when times were good and prosperity, they say, oh, we're responsible for what good times you have. In bad times, they say, oh, the times are bad in spite of us. We did everything we could to offset it. Even in the depth of the Depression in 1932 and 33, the chairman of the Federal Reserve Board was saying, you cannot imagine how much worse things would have been if we hadn't done our duty. But Alan Greenspan is the first chairman of the Federal Reserve who, in public testimony before Congress, said, we may have made a mistake. And I give him very high marks for that. So, as I say, this has been a system which has done far more harm than good. And I am concerned with the question of how can we rein them in so that they do less harm and more good. And the problem is to exercise accountability, to make them accountable. And there are various ways in which this could be done. The main thing I've always argued for, and I'm not sure it's the best way, and indeed, a former student of mine has suggested what I now think is a better way, but what I've always argued for is requiring them to keep the quantity of money growing at a steady and relatively slow rate. They've departed from that, and every single mistake is connected with a departure from that, almost always. There are one or two occasions on which the departure was justified, but most of the time it has not been. And the problem is, how do you get that rule in law, and how do you make it accountable? How do you make it in the self-interest of the members of the board to follow the rule? As I say, there are various other ways that have been suggested, but that's the essential problem, is to impose rules which will keep the quantity of money from either growing very rapidly or declining very rapidly. Either the one or the other is bad. If it grows too rapidly, you have inflation. If it declines too rapidly, you have depression. You're not going to get rid of minor recessions. But even the present recession, in which we are now as we talk, has unquestionably been made deeper than it need be, because over the past 4 months, the Federal Reserve has let the money supply grow at a very, very low rate, much too low a rate. A lower rate, if the rate at which it's been growing over the past 4 months were maintained indefinitely, we would get not stable prices, but declining prices. And what we ought to aim for is a rate of growth of the money supply, which gives you relatively stable prices. They're always shifting their rhetoric. You have to distinguish rhetoric from substance. They've often talked about paying attention to money growth, but they almost never have done so. And that's because they come out of a banker mentality. And the banker mentality is to look at the Fed as a credit instrument and as having something to do with interest rates. It would be too complicated for this present purpose to explain that, but it's a major mistake, in my opinion. And I believe the Fed can influence interest rates, but it can't determine them. But it can determine what the quantity of money is. That's the one thing it can really control. And it ought to be judged on the basis of how well it does that one thing. It doesn't have a positive effect on our economic life. It eliminates a negative effect. Fluctuations in the rate of growth of the quantity of money produce uncertainty. They go up, and prices start to go up, and no individual businessman knows whether the price rise is because his product is in more demand and he should produce it, or because there's more money around and there's going to be general inflation. He won't learn about that for months. And so, let me see if I can describe it in what I think is a proper kind of a metaphor. Consider listening to the radio. The problem that bothers you is static. What matters for the economy is what happens to relative prices and relative demands. What you want is a system under which if people suddenly decided that they want more of one thing and less of another, they want more computers and fewer automobiles. That's reflected in prices, relative prices. The price of computers goes up, the price of automobiles goes down. The producers of computers have an incentive to produce more computers. The producers of automobiles have an incentive to produce fewer automobiles. That's what the price system is like, and that's what it's for. Now, the effect of these fluctuations in the quantity of money is to introduce static into the signals that are coming out from the price system. It's as if when you listen to the radio, somebody is deliberately introducing static into that thing so you can't hear anything very clearly. And that's exactly what these fluctuations in the money supply do. A stable rate of monetary growth would not be a positive good. It would simply set a stable background against which the market could operate, and it would eliminate the static, the uncertainty that these short-term movements introduce. Well, it's hard to know. I don't think you ever have that sense. I think when I went off to college, I knew I liked mathematics, and I was pretty good at mathematics. And I was an ignorant boy in a small town, in a family that had never had anybody who had gone to college. I didn't know what you used mathematics for, and the only thing I could find out was that it was used in the insurance industry somehow. So I started to bone up on actuarial work, and I was going to become an actuary. And indeed, there is a thing called actuarial fellows, that you have to pass a series of examinations for in order to become a member. And while I was not a graduate, I took some of those examinations. They're about the hardest examinations in the world, as anybody will tell you, in mathematics, and I failed some and passed some, but I passed some before. So that was my original intention. I just wanted to be able to make a living out of math. But then when I got into college, I got started getting involved in economics as well as mathematics. And it was also a propitious time. I started college in 1928, and by 1930, when I was a sophomore, the economy was started to go into a decline. By 1931 and 32, it was, of course, a precipitous decline. And it became clear that an enormously important problem was what was going to happen to the economy, that seemed the most dominant thing. But yet, even when I was a senior, I wasn't sure what I was going to do, partly because I didn't have any money, and I needed to get some help if I was going to go anywhere. So as it happened, I applied for and received graduate scholarships. In those days, these weren't fellowships. All this paid for was tuition. And I received two, one from University of Chicago in economics, and one from Brown University in mathematics. So I had to make up my mind at that point whether I was going to go in the direction of mathematics or in the direction of economics. And what made up my mind for me, of course, was the state of the world. In 1932, with that choice before you, economics seemed most clearly and obviously the most important place where a young man should put his energies. Here was this great paradox of millions of people out of work and millions of people hungry. And you couldn't get the people who needed the goods and services together with the people who were in a position to produce them. So that when I really was faced up to that choice, I really didn't have any doubt. If I hadn't gotten a scholarship from Chicago, I would have had to go to Brown because I couldn't afford, I didn't believe that I could afford to I had worked my way through college. I had had a tuition scholarship to Rutgers University where I went to undergraduate, but I had earned all the rest of my expenses, and indeed, I graduated with a small kitty, but not enough to have paid even one quarter a year's tuition, let alone several years. So I had to go where I could get the help, and fortunately, I got a scholarship at Chicago thanks to one of my teachers at Rutgers who had been a University of Chicago student and who was close to some of the faculty people there. My father died when I was 13 years old. So my mother was a very intelligent, able woman. But she was not an intellectual. My father was not an intellectual. Neither one of them had ever gone, well, as a fact, I doubt that either one of them had ever gone through anything beyond elementary. They knew how to read and write, but they were in small private business. We had a small retail store at the time that my mother ran, and that was a source of the livelihood, and also was a source of enormous aggravation because you were always owing more money. Throughout their whole lives, they never had an income, which if you measured it by today's, what we call a poverty level, which is, in my opinion, a very uncertain and meaningless standard. But if you measured it by that, they never in their whole lives had an income that came anywhere close to the poverty level. And yet, they never regarded themselves as poor because they were self-sufficient. They might be in difficult economic straits. We never had any great luxuries or anything. But we always had enough to eat. We always were clothed so that we were not a scandal or a shame on the community. And none of us would have said we were poor. We certainly were not rich. And many of the night, early in my life, when I've heard my mother and father stay up at night worrying about where they were going to get the money to pay the bills the next day, and from time to time they would have to borrow from friends or relatives or something to meet the tax. From time to time they were what's known as kite checks, that is, write checks for the future that they didn't have any money to pay on, but they expected to get the money by the time they came around. But at the same time, they were hardworking, independent people who always made a living in the sense of, that I've mentioned. But they were not intellectuals in any way. And it wouldn't have occurred to them to comment on my interest in mathematics or economics because that wouldn't have been meaningful to them. That was not their realm of discourse. Remember, I was a first-generation American. And I think you will find this same experience in many generations. I know it's the same experience my wife and her family, her peers had. Their parents were enormously anxious for them to be educated and schooled. There's no doubt about that. My parents, insofar as they could, would have sacrificed anything to make it possible for me to go to college. Fortunately, as it happened, with the one exception, that's not entirely true. As I say, my mother never had anything more than a very low income. My family had one great piece of good fortune during the Depression, which was an older sister of mine worked for the Western Union Telegraph Company, and she was employed throughout the Depression, so that they had a steady source of income, and she was unmarried and lived at home and contributed to the family. I was able to earn all my own way throughout college, and as I say, ended up with a little kitty. But the only year I was really in trouble was my first year of graduate study at Chicago. And I borrowed money from my parents, from my mother and my sister, that I was later able to repay, $100 or something like that. It's not a great amount. So that fortunately, they weren't put to the test. But I know the same thing was true of my wife's parents. My wife's brother, who became a very important economist, our errand director, was himself an immigrant to this country. One of these remarkable stories, like Arthur Burns. Arthur Burns the same. Arthur Burns came over to the United States at the age of 10 or 12. I think, 12. He came from Austria. And by the time he was 23, he had gone through, not speaking a word of English, of course, by the time he was about 23, he had gone through elementary school, high school, and graduated from college, and a member of Phi Beta Kappa, and so on. And the same thing with my brother-in-law, Aaron. He came about the age of 12, not speaking a word of English, and in 10 years, he was a graduate of Yale. And without any, his mother would occasionally send him $5 or $10 because that's all she could scrape up, but the rest of it he had to earn on his own. And so did I. This idea that's present now, that somehow or other it is necessary to have great government subsidies to enable people to go to college, is not true. At no time, and our own experiences show it, has it been impossible for people who had the requisite desire and ambition, were willing to work hard. It was, at no time was it impossible for him to get through college. Scholarships for tuition, for paying the cost, those all are very helpful and I think are very desirable. But I think our present arrangements, under which we subsidize so extensively people on an across-the-board basis without a question of merit or anything, or need, are very undesirable. But anyway, that's a separate question. But to go back to your question, people like me, were of a new generation, and we were in a different world. It wasn't their world. The world they had grown up in had been an altogether different world. And so if I had said to my mother, you know, I'm going to be interested in mathematics, she would have said, what's that? And let me emphasize, it was not because they were uninterested or unwilling to make sacrifices. Not because they didn't value intellectual activities very highly, but because they were not sophisticated. I grew up in a, as I say, in a family which my mother and father were both immigrants from Europe, but they had both come over as teenagers and met in this country. And it was a rather typical Jewish family, and as you know, Jews have always valued intellectual activity very highly. And I was always very much interested in intellectual activity. That is, I was a voracious reader as a young man, and I did very well in school and so on. So that it really never occurred to me that I was going to do anything else but go on to college if I could manage to get the money to do it. Every kind. Fiction, mostly fiction, of course. That's what I think young people, young kids, I shouldn't say young people, children, between 6 and 16, are inclined to read mostly as fiction, and I read all kinds of fiction. I had a small library, the Railway Public Library, and I exhausted whatever they had on their shelves. Jack London wrote a marvelous book called The Scarlet Plague, which I must say, for some reason, is the one book I remember best out of that period. It had to do with the Scarlet Plague as a novel, and has to do with there's a illness, a Scarlet Plague, that comes to the country. People die out all over the world, all over the United States, except for small isolated colonies that are left. Advanced civilization collapses, the buildings in New York are empty and so on. And here's a boy who's suddenly growing up and comes in the wilderness of California, as it happens, and he stumbles over a railroad track, which has by now been almost buried in the dirt. And he asks his grandfather or his father about that, and then you hear the story about this plague that wiped out mankind and how in isolated places they are gradually coming back. I don't know why that one stuck in my mind so much, but it did. One of them was an early conflict over religious beliefs, internally, not externally. My parents were Orthodox Jews, but they weren't fanatic about it. They weren't. They observed the dietary laws and so on, but there was nothing fanatic about it. They weren't, but I was. And in my early years, I was fanatic about it. If this was right, if this was a religion, you should do what you had to do. And so I was scrupulous be at about the age of 11 or 12, maybe 13. Not quite 13, I guess 11 or 12, 10, 11, 12. I was an enormously observant Jew. I remember once going on a joint Boy Scout trip, a trip with a number of Boy Scout troops, at which they were going to have hot dogs for lunch, and they were not kosher hot dogs. So I ran away because I didn't have the courage to stand up and say I wasn't going to eat them. That was a defect of my character, and I simply ran away. But then, somehow or other, and I don't know where, I began to question it. And when I finally decided that there was no fundamental basis for it, that all of this was mostly myth and prejudice, then I went the other way, and my wife will tell you that I became fanatically anti-religious. So that was one set of defining events, which certainly had a very great impact on me. A very different set is of another kind that I can tell you very quickly. I had a teacher in high school who was really, somehow I think he taught government or political science, something like that, whatever you call it in high school. But he also taught Euclidean geometry, plain geometry, simply because he liked it as such a beautiful intellectual discipline. And I took his course, and one point or another, he got rhapsodizing about the beauty of geometry, and he quoted the last lines of Keats's Ode to a Grotian Urn. Truth is beauty, beauty is truth. That is all you know and all you need to know. And those two lines stuck with me. I was about probably 12 or 13 at the time. And they have stuck with me ever since because they so much reflected the sort of feeling I had about the geometry as well and about mathematics in general, that its appeal is one of beauty, kind of an intellectual purity and beauty. Now, that was just, I'm sure that that was what drove me in the direction of thinking I wanted to make mathematics my lifetime work. I hope and I believe I've tried to examine what their actual effects have been as opposed to what their intentions were. That is to say, I think that the great problem in so many of these areas is to distinguish between rhetoric and substance. There's, as you very well know, there's a famous saying that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And that's the case. Almost all government programs are started with good intentions. But when you look at what they actually achieve, there's a general rule. Almost every such program has results that are the opposite of the intentions of the well-meaning people who originally backed it. I say well-meaning because in every such case, there are people who are doing it because they believe it would be good for the country. Unless you have some people like that, it's hard to get anything through. On the other hand, it's also hard to get through unless there's a core of people who can see how they personally can benefit from having that policy put into effect. And in some cases, the results, not in all, but in some cases, the results do coincide with their expectations. But they're almost always the opposite of the intentions of the well-meaning people. Now, I don't believe that's a general skepticism about everything. I think that's rather, the old American saying, I'm from Missouri, show me. I don't want to go ahead on promises. You want to look at what actually happens. And so I believe that the attitude there has been a combination of the real training I got in the field of economics, the attitude toward economics as concerned with real problems and as a machine, one of the great economists said, machinery, as a bit of machinery with which to examine the real effects of real policies on the one hand, and the desire to see what actually happened as opposed to what people say will happen. This one man I mentioned who taught plain geometry did have that influence, and there were a number of other high school teachers. One who taught Latin, as a matter of fact, which I never became very expert in, but I did take. who happened to be a very young man who had just recently graduated from college and who for that reason was closer to the high school students under him. And somehow or other he, I think, had a real influence on me in encouraging me to go ahead and try to go on to college to become more educated, more trained. But in high school, those are about the only people I can really think of during the, as it were, before I went on to college. Now, once I went on to college, there were some other people who had some very great and real influence on me. During my undergraduate college people, there are two people who stick out who unquestionably had a major influence on them. One of them was Arthur Burns, who later on became the chairman of the Federal Reserve Board and still later ambassador to Germany, and was a very important politician. Not politician, I'm sorry, he wasn't ever a politician, but he was a very important influence in the political area. He was chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors under President Eisenhower. He was a close advisor of President Nixon. He was a President Nixon appointed him chairman of the Federal Reserve Board, and President Ford, I guess, reappointed him. And as I say, subsequently, under President Reagan, he was ambassador to Germany. So he was a very strong influence. But my association with him was long before those times. And he was a very relatively young man when I was a undergraduate. In fact, he was just in the process of trying to complete his doctoral dissertation at Columbia. And I would say one of the most important, most valuable courses I ever took in my life was a course I had with Arthur. I call him Arthur because he later became a very close friend, personal friend of mine. And we were friends for all of his life, and he died a few years ago. There's nobody except outside of my parents. As I said, I gave a little talk at a memorial ceremony for Arthur after his death. And as I said, outside of my parents and my wife, there's nobody else who had as much influence on my life as Arthur Burns did. And as I say, that major source of influence started exerting itself during a course I took in which there were only two students and me. And this course consisted, I don't know what it was supposed to be, but it consisted in going over the draft of his doctoral dissertation, sentence by sentence, and trying to find mistakes in it and analyze it and improve it and criticize it. And as I say, I can think of but one other course in my life that has as much value to me as that course, because it supplied standards of workmanship, the level of accuracy you want to aim at, the openness to criticism. Those are the kinds of things it provided. Arthur was a great scholar. He was at he went from Rutgers. He was only stayed at Rutgers for a few years, and then he became a professor at Columbia University. And he went from, and at Columbia University was associated with a research organization called the National Bureau of Economic Research, and he worked there with Wesley Mitchell. You read in the papers today about the leading indicators. Those leading indicators derived from the work of Arthur Burns and Wesley Mitchell at the National Bureau of Economic Research during the 1930s. Henry Morgenthau, when he was Secretary of the Treasury, asked Mitchell if he would, Wesley Mitchell, who was a very famous economist at the time and who was head of the National Bureau before Arthur was, if he would develop some way of trying to forecast what was going to happen to the economy that they could use at the Treasury. And he and Arthur, and mostly Arthur, produce this set of leading indicators, or I shouldn't say the present set, but they produce the original set, which is a great grandfather of the present set. So that Arthur certainly had an enormous influence. And the other person there who had an enormous influence on me was the man I mentioned who really was responsible for my going to Chicago, Homer Jones. Homer Jones was at the time a graduate student at Chicago, who, however, had taken a job as an instructor at Rutgers because he needed the money, and he had been working there for a couple of years, and he was a relatively young man, but also he had a very real influence on me because of his understanding of economic analysis, and also because of his qualities as a teacher and as a human being. He was a great human being. Homer subsequently also went to Washington to work with the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, and then he became a vice president of the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis, and really had a great deal of importance in the area of central banking and monetary policies. And Homer was something of a disciple of, or a student of, Frank Knight at the University of Chicago, Frank H. Knight. And through Knight, he persuaded Chicago to offer me a tuition scholarship, and that's how I happened to go to the University of Chicago. So those two people unquestionably had the greatest influence. I mean, now there are other people who, obviously other professors, other teachers, and so on, who had an influence on me, but those two stand out. People grossly underestimate the role of luck and chance in people's lives. Let me illustrate it. If the United States, in the 1880s and 1890s, had the kind of laws it has now, my parents would never have been able to come to the United States. They would not have gotten visas. They would not have gotten in there. If they had met and gotten married, they would have been in where they came from, an area of, in their lifetime, it was, or when they left it, it was Hungary, Austro-Hungary. It was Carpatho-Ruthenia. It later was at the tail eastern end of the in-between wars Czechoslovakia, and is currently a province of Russia. So that if they had been unable to come to the United States, if they had stayed there and gotten married there and I was born and all that, I'd now be a citizen of Russia. Pure chance. I had nothing to do with it. One point after another, pure chance. If Homer Jones hadn't happened to be teaching at Rutgers at the time I went there, I never would have had the opportunity to go to Chicago. I would certainly not have become an economist. I would probably have become an applied mathematician. I don't know what I would have done in that area. And so it goes. There are pure chance plays an enormous role in the lives of all of us. Now, I don't mean to say that everything is due to chance. Certainly it is not. Certainly character matters. Certainly whether people are willing to work hard. Certainly pure IQ matters. And that's a matter of chance too. Pure random chance of which half of which parent's genes you happen to get. So that character, intelligence, and so on matter. But I think accident matters an enormous amount. Whether people happen to be in the right place at the right time, whether people happen to get hit by an automobile, you know, there are all sorts of things. I think the most important single thing on people's success is whether they are lucky enough to be able to earn their living at doing something that if they could afford to, they would do without any pay. I think the most unlucky people in the world are those who have to earn their living by doing something in which they are not willing, they would not voluntarily work overtime. Now, millions of people have to do that. They are the most unluckiest people, and the luckiest people are people like myself who, by accident, are able to earn their living by doing something that if they could afford to, they would do without getting paid. If you don't really want to work overtime at a job, you shouldn't have that job. The notion that you can anticipate developments in the economy goes back well over centuries. In the 19th century, William Stanley Jevons, an economist of that time, who was one of the pioneers in economic statistics, but also an economic theorist, He developed an idea, which people tend to laugh at, which had some point to it, that the business cycles, oh, let me go back, business cycles, ups and downs and fluctuations, go all the way back hundreds of years. And they were studied very seriously in the 19th century by quite a number of people. He developed the idea that they were linked to the cycle in sunspots. Astronomers and people concerned with that kind of discipline had developed the notion that sunspots went in about a 10-year cycle. And as it happened, the economic cycle was also a 10-year cycle. And while people think, oh, well, that's just mythology, it's nothing of the kind. His theory was that the sunspots influenced the weather. The weather influenced agricultural productivity and output. And since at the time, agriculture was a dominant industry worldwide, it wasn't foolish to think that you might, through that mechanism, have an influence from the sunspots on the economic cycle. And so he had a way of trying to forecast the cycle through the sunspots. And then in the 1920s, for coming back closer, there was a group at Harvard which published a bulletin devoted entirely, almost entirely, to trying to analyze and forecasting the movements of the economic cycle. There were the people at the Federal Reserve System was established in 1914, and certainly had quite a research division, and the members of that research division during the 1930s were trying to do it. No. And then, to get cap it all, Wesley Mitchell, whom I mentioned, had written his major work, really his major lifetime work, was a book that was published in 1913 on business cycles, which was an attempt to analyze what business cycles, and that followed. That was what led to the creation of the National Bureau of Economic Research, which Wesley Mitchell was one of the founders of in New York in 1921. And the National Bureau were the first people who produced estimates of, well, I shouldn't say they were the first people, there were earlier, but the first systematic studies of national income, and of and it was devoted largely to the study of business cycles from its very beginning. And it was they were called down to Washington by Morgenthau precisely because of Wesley Mitchell's background in this whole area. He was at what at the time had been regarded as the world's greatest authority on business cycles. But it was just that the Treasury wanted something that it could use and it could look at. That's where the leading indicators were born. The idea of the leading indicators would be that, first of all, it would be relatively easy to calculate and simple to get, so you wouldn't have to have a great panoply of scholars studying a whole series of industries. Second, that the data were fairly readily available. And third, that you could select out some series which had some economic activities which had the property that they tended to move very early in the cycle. We call them the leading indicators. But as a matter of fact, there are three sets of indicators. There are the leading indicators, the coincident indicators, and the lagging indicators. Series that move early in the cycle, series that move contemporaneously with the cycle, and series that move late in the cycle. For example, in general, historically, what happens to inventories and what happens to the quantity of money both tend to move early in the cycle and are both in leading indicators. What happens to unemployment tends to come late. Unemployment continues to go down until after the cyclical peak has been reached. It doesn't start to go up until after the trough has been reached. It's late. It doesn't start to go down until after the trough has been reached. So unemployment is one of the lagging indicators. So you have these three sets, and the idea was that the leading indicators would give you some idea that maybe there was trouble ahead. The coincident indicators would confirm it, and the lagging indicators would confirm it even more strongly. I've been very fortunate. I've had setbacks, but I've had no really major traumatic setbacks. I was very, very fortunate after and again, it's pure accident. I happened to graduate from college in 1932. I did a year of graduate work at Chicago from 32 to 33. And then, again, this is pure accident. I got a fellowship at Columbia the next year, which was an enormous boon to me. I had never seen so much money in my life. It was $1,500, of which $300 went for tuition. Out of the other $1,500, I paid back the debts I had accumulated the next year, the prior year. And at the end, I saw more Broadway shows that year than I ever have in my life in one year. Because that was during the Depression when you would go downtown, down to Gray's Bookstore in Broadway and pick up a ticket to the best show in town for 50 cents because they were being sold cut rate. And I had enough money left at the end of the year to finance a real summer's vacation, which I had never had before, and I had usually worked in the summers with a friend of mine up in Canada. So that was real, really. And again, pure luck. Why was it lucky? Well, it so happened there was a professor at the University of Chicago, Henry Schultz, a mathematical economist with whom I established a good relation, who happened to have a good friend at Columbia, Harold Hotelling, who was also a mathematical economist and one of the great ones. And he, through Hotelling, he got me a fellowship at Columbia. So I, and then I, the next year, I went back to Chicago and worked for Henry Schultz as his research assistant. And then the New Deal came along. And while the New Deal was not good for the country in many ways, it was very good for me. Because I was able to get a job in Washington at the National Resources Committee in Washington, doing work that I enjoyed very much and that was very much along the line of my own interest in development. And then after that, I was able to get a job at the National Bureau of Economic Research in New York, where I effectively wrote. People nowadays have the idea that when you get your PhD degree, you go right straight through. You first study, and then you write your PhD, and then you get your PhD, and then you go out in the market. And that's only because of changed financial arrangements. In my time, very few people wrote their PhD in residence. When they got their courses through and were able to afford to get that paid, they went out and got a job, and while they were working on their own spare time, they wrote a dissertation. Well, and that was my case, except that I was lucky enough so that I got a job at a research institution, National Bureau of Economic Research, to work with Simon Kuznets, who was a great economist. Also received a Nobel Prize in economics before he died. And Simon was doing a study in on the incomes of independent professional people that I was hired to assist him on, and that ended up as a book published jointly by him and me, part of which became my dissertation. Perhaps the most traumatic event of that period of my life was the next year, 1940-41, I guess, when I was able to get, I've left out, of course, the most important event of that period, which was getting married. But leaving that aside, we went out to Wisconsin on a visiting arrangement for a year, University of Wisconsin, the Department of Economics. And I got involved in the center, embroiled in the center, of an internal dispute and became it really was quite a storm. There was a conflict. There was a business school that was trying to take over the economics department. And there was a dean of the arts and sciences who was trying to improve what he thought was a mediocre economics department. And he offered me a tenured position at Wisconsin, and I accepted it. But then all hell broke loose, and the people in the business school and some of the people in the economics department started to complain about how this arrogant dean was trying to force me down their throat, and I was this young branch man from New York, and he was offering me a higher salary. I think it was all of, what was it, $2,600 a year? I think that was maybe it was $3,000. It was that order of magnitude. And he was offering me that, and that was higher than they were paying somebody else. So anyway, as I say, the real thing that was happening was a dispute between the economics department and the School of Business. But I became the center of it, and it also involved elements of anti-Semitism. In Wisconsin, this was in 1940, when there was a war had started in Europe, but not here, and when, and Wisconsin, as you know, had a large German population, and there were a number of people in the economics department who were very strong sympathizers with Germany, and as is not surprising, I was not on that thing, and I had spoken very openly my belief that the United States ought to go into war on the side of the Allies. So at any rate, that got involved. And, as soon as it, when it got to that point, I just quit. I asked the dean to withdraw my name from consideration and quit. So that, but nonetheless, that was a very traumatic experience. And I have since had been involved in similar public disputes, but that was the earliest and the defining one, as if I may say so for me. I had been lucky. I had grown up in a small town, Rahway, New Jersey, where there were about 100 Jewish families, and I had never encountered any real anti-Semitism. I was very much impressed when I went to Columbia, where there were Jewish fellow graduate students who became friends of mine. And I was very much impressed that they were much more sensitive to that issue than I was. Again, because of the accident and in the small town I grew up in, I never really felt any anti-Semitism, anything, as I say. I may have imposed things on myself because of my own religious beliefs, but I was never discriminated against that I could see in any way. And similarly, I had that same experience in college. I never felt it. In Chicago, I never felt it. The first time I really became aware that this was a major problem was when I went to Columbia, met students who had grown up in New York, where a third of the population was Jewish, where this was a very serious and real issue. So that I didn't regard the anti-Semitism as a key issue in the Wisconsin thing, and that didn't really affect me very greatly. It just happened to be one of the aspects of it that was very unpleasant. That was the thing about it. For the rest, it was my introduction to academic politics, and it was very valuable to me. You know, there are no politics that are as dirty as academic politics, and the reason is very simple. If you fight over very little, the only pleasure in it is in the fight and not in what you get. It's really amazing. Consider any academic department of anything. One of the members wins a lottery ticket for $1 million. His fellow colleagues will come around and pat him on his back and tell him how lucky he is, and they'll be envious, but there'll be no malice in it. The same colleague, because he happens to be get an offer from another university or for whatever reason, gets a raise of $500 above the other people. All hell breaks loose. There's malice. That's disgraceful. That's terrible. That's special treatment. That's academic politics. Because there's very little at stake. And therefore, people fight very hard about it when they fight about it. And academic politics can be as dirty as any politics in the world. And my introduction to that was the Wisconsin affair. And it taught me that I am going to stay clear of that kind of politics for the rest of my life. And fortunately, fortunately, I've never again been involved in anything of that nature. Undoubtedly, my parents to begin with, and undoubtedly my wife, of course. We met at the University of Chicago as graduate students. She was studying economics as I was. We both came to the same course, and this is I mentioned earlier that there was one other course in my life that I thought had a similar influence to me as did Arthur Burns's course. And that was this particular course, first one I took first quarter at the University of Chicago, a course in pure economic theory, with Jacob Viner, a great teacher. And Rose, my wife, and I were both in that same class, and Professor Viner, in order to get to know his students, seated them alphabetically. Her name began with D and mine with F, so we were seated next to one another. See how luck plays a role? But that was our first meeting, and we were married 6 years later. We've been married for 52 years since then. And there's no question that she's had the greatest personal influence on my life. You know, I think economics is a very fascinating subject. But I'm sure also that if I had become a mathematician, I would have found that an equally absorbing subject. No, I don't really think I've ever gotten bored with my work. Now, of course, there are parts of it that you enjoy more than other parts. And some parts are real drudgery, but you have to pay the drudgery. But the parts you really enjoy are the creative parts. And the parts, what you pay for it, is when you, A, have to write it down, but you do have to write it down. And B, when you edit and rewrite. And I think one of the defects in the work of most people is that they don't do enough rewriting and editing. Another experience that had a great influence on me was involved the gentleman I've already mentioned, Wesley Mitchell. When I was working at the National Bureau of Economic Research with Simon Kuznets, and we wrote jointly, I did most of the writing, I guess, on it, that's on this particular thing, what was published as a bulletin about the preliminary results of our studies. And we wrote a draft of it, and Mitchell, who was a director of research and the head of the institution, read it, and he came in and he said, you know, Simon came to this country as an adult. He was born in Russia. He was educated, schooled in Russia. He came here about when he was 18 or 20, I've forgotten, but then he went to college in the United States and became. So he said there's some excuse for him not writing very good English. But you were born in this country. There's no excuse for you not writing English. And he gave me holy hell for the sloppiness with which I had written that. And he said, you know, people always say, oh, I know what I mean, but I can't express it. And he said to me correctly, if you can't express accurately what you mean, you don't know what you mean. And I must say that that episode has had a very big influence, a major influence, on that aspect of my life. And he was absolutely right. He himself was a beautiful writer and speaker. If he spoke extemporaneously, the sentences would come out perfect. You'd start on a long sentence and think he wasn't going to finish properly, and he would, and it would be elegant, good English. It's a rare gift, and I've known very few other people who had it. I play tennis. I ski. That's not a full-time hobby, obviously. That only happened sporadically. And I didn't begin that until I was age 40. And walk. And of course, those are the physical hobbies. And I think as you get older, you have to be more and more certain that you carry on physical activity of a rather disciplined kind. But outside of that, I would say my major hobby has always been widespread reading. My wife is an avid gardener, and I occasionally serve as a laborer on her behalf, and I am kind of an amateur carpenter. I have a workshop, and I work with wood, and I build things, and so on. My wife's brother-in-law, whom we've always been close to, and who also has had a great influence on me, and Aaron was he's now very old, he's 10 years older than I am, but he's still fortunately alive. But Aaron was a very, really good cabinet worker. And so he and I jointly, and a third person in Chicago, I guess three of us together, jointly made a whole bunch of walnut couches, long couches that are really beautiful objects and very comfortable and very nice. And there is great satisfaction in sitting on them. And I've made lots of other things on my own, of course, also. But I've really had a schizophrenic kind of a life. And because one part of my life has been purely what I would call relatively purely scientific, positive, non-ideological, concerned with trying to understand how the world works. And another part of my activity, which began fairly late, so far as my life career is concerned, has been trying to influence public policy. That's been ideological. Concerned not simply with abstract ideas, but also with values. That's a course. It's a second part of my life which has received more public attention, for which, if you ask people about me, they probably know, more people will know about that aspect of my life. But it has been sort of, you ask my hobby, that's sort of been a hobby of mine, as it were, an avocation. My real vocation has been scientific economics, positive economics. People get a great misconception about economics. They think, oh, what the devil? If there are two economists in a room, they have three ideas. That's wrong. On the great bulk of issues, most economists agree. But you don't talk about the things you agree about. And what gets into the press, what's newsworthy, are the disagreements and not the agreements. And where are the disagreements? On those parts of the discipline that are least well developed and that you know least about. You find exactly the same thing in other disciplines. Here's physics. People think of it as a pure, hard scientific discipline, but when it comes to issues where values enter in very much, such as whether you ought to have SDI, for example, or not, you don't have the physicists speaking with a single voice. They're divided into camps and into groups. It's no different in all disciplines. Whenever values enter in, something different happens. But if you stick to the scientific part of the discipline, there is an enormous amount of agreement among economists. I have often had young people who became very much interested in policy, in whatever kind, who have wanted to devote their life to promoting what they thought were the right policies. And I have always advised them, look, that's all right as an avocation. But don't do that as your vocation. You get to do something and earn your living on something which you enjoy doing, but which is non-ideological and non-policy oriented, and then do the rest as a sideline. Because if you once start going along the other line, sooner or later you're going to lose your sense of objectivity. You're going to become a kind of a fanatic, a pure ideologue. You're not going to have this balance to it, which you want to have if you want to keep yourself an open-minded person. You're very much dependent on the kind of sources of income that you don't want to become dependent on. Because you will find that you have special interests who will support you as long as your ideological preconception meets their special interest. But they won't have anything to do with you if it doesn't. And therefore, if you try to make your living that way, you're always having to come up against a situation where you have to decide whether you're going to sacrifice your principles in order to be able to get the money you need in order to achieve something else. That is to say, you're, well, maybe I'll bend a little in this direction because that way I'll be able to push my other idea. It's not a healthy way. It's not a healthy life. It's not a good life, in my opinion. If you work, if you get some kind of a solid base, I don't care whether it's, I'm not saying it should be intellectual. Go into business. But get yourself an independent base so that you can really be truly consistent and stick to your principles. You don't have to modify them in order to satisfy somebody else. People don't realize how hard it is to have truly free speech. Very few people in the United States are in a position where they can express what they really believe freely and without inhibition. No head of a business is, almost no head of a business is, very few. Because if one way or another the ideas they express are going to offend some source of income for their firm, they're in trouble. I can give you some very simple examples. Here, during the 1950s, 40s, and since, the U.S. has been issuing savings bonds. There's been a great deal of propaganda to buy savings bonds. For much of that period, though, that was the biggest bucket shop operation in history, because the government was issuing savings bonds, which, when they were redeemed, would enable you to buy less than the initial price would have purchased. You paid $100 for a savings bond, you got 3 or 4% interest, but the inflation rate was 5 or 6 or 7%. When you got back the $125, $150 at the end of the period, it would buy less than the $100 did at the beginning. You were paying for the privilege of saving. It was a bucket shop operation. It was a disgraceful operation. I think it should never have been engaged in. All right, now, during much of that period, every bank in the United States, in sending your monthly statement to its depositors, would include a brochure advertising the virtues of savings bonds as a way of saving for your future. I have talked, at that time, I talked to many bankers, and I said, tell me, do you buy savings bonds for yourself? Of course not. Do you really consider them a good investment? No, they're a terrible investment. Why do you put these brochures in your slip? Oh, because the Treasury wouldn't like it if we didn't. Again, there were formed committees, savings bond committee. They had big advertisements in the paper with the pictures of all these great people on there, advising people to buy savings bonds. 9 out of 10 of those people knew that they were giving very bad advice. And they were all doing it because it was very important for them to be in the good graces of the Treasury or whoever else. Let me give you a very different example that had nothing to do with wartime at all. We're heading towards socialized medicine. You're a professor in a medical school. Your medical school is receiving 2/3 of its income from the U.S. government. You believe that you ought to have strictly private medicine. Would it be easy for you to get up and say that? Not at all. It'd be very, very difficult. I've often said that the only people who have real honest-to-God freedom of speech are tenured professors on the verge of retirement, or who have already retired and have an independent income, like myself. But I think one of the most precious things in life is to be able to say what you believe freely and openly without having to worry too much about the consequence. I say too much. I don't believe that it ought to be costless. If you're going to say unpopular things and you're going to become unpopular as a result, that's going to impose a cost. And sometimes maybe you won't be willing to bear it. But there ought to be no, so to speak, artificial costs or artificial limitations on you. But yet there are on most people. I could give one example after another of the same kind of thing. Right now, you have this terrible situation that's happening in college after college in this country, of a complete intolerance for speech which is not, quote, politically correct. It's come to be a new term that's used, politically correct speech. It's a terrible term. It's a disgraceful term. Correct speech ought to be speech which expresses what a person believes, what he thinks to be the truth. And it's a disgrace that in universities of all places, there should be the kind of censorship that is, in fact, being imposed. Most important of all, what's important is not only freedom to speak, but freedom to listen. I don't think freedom to speak includes being subsidized by anybody. I don't believe it includes freedom to use government facilities like a hall to give a speech. What it includes is, on the one hand, the right to hire a hall, say what you want, and second, and most important, not for the speaker, but for everybody else, the right of everybody else to listen, to hear what they want to hear. And what's happening now is not so much restriction on freedom of speech, but a restriction on freedom to listen. If a professor says something in a course that other people don't like, they come in and disrupt the course so that nobody can listen to them. The people who want to hear them can't hear them. And I think that's absolutely disgraceful. In fact, I think the most important single virtue, human virtue, is tolerance. And tolerance grows out of humility. If you really know the answers, if you really believe that you have the truth, the ultimate truth, you can't. How can you tolerate? How can you let anybody sin? If you really know what sinning is, can you let them sin? No. So the source of tolerance is the recognition that none of us has the truth. We may have very strong feelings, we may have very strong beliefs, but we always have to recognize the possibility. I like to quote a statement that Oliver Cromwell made, which he didn't really believe, but he states it very well, even though he doesn't believe it. By the bowels of Christ, he said, I beseech you, bethink you, you may be mistaken. And that's what's important, that each of us has to believe, well, now, I'm pretty damn sure I'm right. I'm pretty sure I'm right. But there is a chance I may be wrong. Because the other fellow also thinks he's right. And who am I to say that somehow or other the views he holds are less good than the views I hold? So I ought to be free to try to persuade him of my view. He ought to be free to persuade me of his view. But neither of us have the right to coerce the other through physical intimidation. The aim is not to have business operate more profitably. The aim of our society is to have people better off. Profits are a means, not an end. And indeed, in a good society, it's very hard to make profits because you've got a lot of competition, you've got a lot of people trying to participate. We do have. But so far as Congress is concerned, at the moment, we are roughly 50% socialists. Government spending at all levels is now 43% of the national income. In addition, the government imposes regulations and rules on business that clearly take up another 10% or so of our income. So more than 50% of our resources are now being distributed and allocated by government. The best thing government could do, in my opinion, in order to promote the well-being of the consumers, which indeed wouldn't give more opportunity for entrepreneurs to get into business and to open up new business, the best thing government could do would be to cut its size. We have a great deal of downsizing by enterprises now. What we really need is downsizing by government. One more point. If you look at our real social problems, not our economic problems, but our social problems, almost all of them have been produced by government. We have one of our major problems, which has been mentioned, is that our school system is unsatisfactory. Why? Because in the main, it's a government monopoly. The private schools, on the whole, do a very much better job than government schools, just as socialism in general does a poorer job than private enterprise. What goes bad is that nobody spends somebody else's money as carefully as he spends his own. That's fundamentally what goes bad. It isn't that people are bad. The same people, on the one hand, spending their own money, and on the other hand, spending somebody else's money, will behave very differently. And what goes bad is that people are sincere. The people who run the school system want to do a good job. They aren't bad people. It's not that at all. But they have no competition. They don't have to prove themselves. And therefore, they tend to stress their own interests. In the case of the school system, of course, the main problem, a major problem, is the extent of influence of the teachers' unions. The National Education Association
is the largest pressure group in the country. It has an annual income of $750 million, and it doesn't hesitate to spend that to try to promote its own interests. In fact, it's perfectly open and above board that its purpose is not to promote education. Its purpose is to promote the well-being of its members. And I don't blame them for that. That's what they're there for. But if you ask what goes wrong, in my opinion, that's what goes wrong. Free market principles apply. The reason we have a healthcare crisis is because we're not following free market principles. Why in the world should you buy your health at the company store? The company store is an old anachronism which people try to avoid. The only reason we get our health through our employers in the main is because there's a tax gimmick under which if the employer pays for it, the employee doesn't have to pay tax on it. Whereas if he pays for it himself, it has to come out of after-tax income. The proposal that would enable free market principles to work, see, the basic free market principle is that an individual spends his own money and decides what he wants to buy. That's not the free market principle you now have in health. People aren't spending their own money. The employer is spending it.
Well, I am, but I seem to be the only.
What's been proposed and what I think would be a major step toward a free market system would be the so-called MediSave accounts, whereby you'd retain this tax gimmick, but have the employer put the money in an account in an individual's own name, and he or she would be responsible himself for purchasing his medical care. And then that would enable free market principles to work. Look, we've had socialized medicine in Germany, in Sweden, in Britain, in Canada. All of these countries are having difficulty with it. There's not one of them that doesn't have long waiting periods, in which expenses have not been going up, in which you don't have a real problem. So we're not going to solve our medical problem by socializing. I think there's been a great myth about Japan and the United States. Japan has done very well, but it is not Japan Incorporated. It's not a miracle run by the Japanese MITI, Ministry for Industry and Trade. And that miracle, supposed miracle, has collapsed, of course, in the last few years. You had a bubble economy with a stock market that was way out of line. It's come down, it's been cut in half. Japan is experiencing a severe recession. The output has been going down, not up. It's not a miracle country at all. And most important of all, if you ask the real question, the important question, what is the level of living of the people of Japan? Not what are these numbers about national income or GNP or balance of trade, but how well do the people in Japan live? You discover that they don't live that well. That the level of living, as best we can judge it in Japan, is about two-thirds to three-quarters of that in the United States. Go back to the reference to manufacturing. Employment in manufacturing has been going down, but manufacturing output has been going up sharply because productivity has been increasing. The problem in Japan is that they had a limited number of industries, those which were involved in the export industry, which were doing very, very well, like electronics, automobiles, and so on. On the other hand, their distribution system is very backward. The domestic services for people are not what they should be. Housing is small, land is scarce. It's a different kind of a world. And Japan is not a model for us to follow at all. On the contrary, Japan did best 10, 20 years ago when government in Japan was much smaller. What's happened, it's an interesting phenomenon. As government spending in Japan as a fraction of income has approached ours, it's been coming up. It used to be much less than ours. Now it's about equal. The rate of growth of Japan has gone down sharply. It was going up at a rate of about 8 or 10% a year, and then 5% a year, then 4% a year, and now it's going backward, minus. It will recover. Japan is, the people of Japan are are very industrious, they're very hardworking, they have a relatively good educational system. So I'm not running Japan down. But it's not a giant that we have to worry about. So far as NAFTA is concerned, it really is a minor thing from the point of view of the United States. After all, the United States is a very much larger economy than Mexico. The main beneficiary from NAFTA will be Mexico and the people in Mexico, not the people in the United States. There's no doubt in my mind that that is the net effect. And Mexico is doing very well by reducing the scale of role of government, by introducing free market ideas, cutting tariffs, getting government out of business, privatizing banks and other businesses that government had taken over. And NAFTA will be a little extra push for them, which will help them much more. It won't hurt. It'll help us a little, but a trifle. You know, nothing is good unless both parties benefit from it. And both Mexico and the United States will benefit from it. I would hope so. NAFTA is misnamed. It's not a free trade agreement. It's a managed trade agreement. I supported NAFTA as the lesser of evils. But it would really be very much better if we in the United States would simply reduce our tariffs across the board for everybody in the world. But so far as Latin America is concerned, it's been showing remarkable changes, beginning with Chile, going on to Mexico, now Argentina. One country after another in Latin America has unilaterally been lowering its tariffs, opening its markets up. And if we are sensible, we certainly will go as rapidly as we can to expand NAFTA to include all of the rest of the Latin American countries. And I believe that that is, in fact, what will happen. I think what business is doing is creating the goods and services we use. I think it's misleading to talk about business. People are what matters. And the people who are in business are a sample of the people at large. And you might just as well ask, are other people around doing things for us? And there's nothing more important they're doing than providing the food on the table, the clothes that we wear, and everything else. Why is it that we're so much better off today in those areas than we were when I was growing up? It's primarily because of the efforts of private business. And yet, as a nation, fewer and fewer of our resources are being devoted to that kind of activity. And where we're wasting money is in trying to do things we can't do.
Okay.
We're wasting money on these agricultural experiment stations in every county, even though there's no agriculture there. I don't think you want to increase the value of your currency. What you want to do is to keep your currency having a relatively constant value. In your own country, the Czech Republic, under Václav Klaus, is showing a very good example to the rest of the world, because the Czech Republic has been doing a remarkable job, in my opinion. Of all of the Eastern European countries, it's probably been doing the best job. It has gone farthest in selling off state enterprises and converting them into private enterprises. The important thing is to have a currency which does not inflate, which keeps its value. And the only way you can do that is by not printing too much of it. There's one reason for inflation, and one only, ultimately, and that's creating too much money. Unfortunately, Poland has not been doing a good job in that respect. Hungary has been doing a moderate job, but I think the Czech Republic has, on the whole, doing rather the best job of the various ones. So, but don't imitate the United States. The United States is not the right model for you. The right model for you is a much more free enterprise society. I would say Hong Kong before the Chinese take over is the best model. Or the right model for you is the way you were in 1938 or 39. People forget that in 1938 or 39, Czechoslovakia was one of the wealthiest countries in the world, with one of the highest incomes. It only took 40 years for communism to reduce it to the status of a third world country. No, we're going the wrong way. I've been putting it in a very simple syllogism. Everybody agrees that capitalism has been a success. Everybody agrees that socialism has been a failure. The conclusion, therefore, we need more socialism. Now, how do you make any sense out of that? You can't, and yet that's exactly what's been happening. Government has been getting bigger. Most of the proposals that are before Congress would involve more government involvement. The health care program is an obvious case. Why? The simple answer is because the people no longer run the government. The government has become a self-generating monstrosity. We don't have government of the people, by the people, for the people. We have government of the people, by the bureaucracy, for the bureaucracy. And by the bureaucracy, I include members of Congress, because being a member of Congress has become a lifetime career. Incumbents, it's very difficult to displace them. In order to change that, in order to follow the rest of the world and move in the direction that we ourselves pioneered, toward a greater role for free markets and for individuals, we need to change the incentives under which government operates. In my opinion, the most promising movement at the moment to produce such a change is the term limits movement, which has been moving like wildfire. State after state has passed a term limit amendment for its constitution. I'm very optimistic about the long run because I think the public at large recognizes what's wrong. The people know the government is too big and needs to be cut down. And sooner or later, the people are going to have their say.
Of course I'm saying I know the answers. I don't deny that. But I don't have any right to make you agree with me. All I have the right to do is to present as best I can my side of the case and to try to persuade you. And of course, I know the answers, but I also know they may be wrong. And if you can persuade me they're wrong, well, then I'll gladly shift my view. And you have just as much right to your view that you know the answers as I do to my view that I do. Now, obviously, what's involved all along is that when you say you know the answers, it's about some things. And the degree of confidence that you have will vary enormously. If you express yourself, as people often do, on things about which they have no confidence, they should have a very low degree of confidence in what they say. If I say, for example, the war in the Gulf is going to be over in a week, I don't have any great confidence in that. Who am I? I'm not a military expert. I don't know what's going on. But nonetheless, I'm entitled to make a judgment, provided I recognize the tentative character of it. On the other hand, when I say, if you print a lot of money, you're going to have inflation, my confidence in that is enormously higher because I can cite hundreds of examples to show that that is exactly what happened and essentially no examples on the other side. But still, I might be wrong. There might be something that comes along that alters that, so I don't doubt that. But still, I have a great deal of confidence in it. The point is, no, we never can know for certain. We think the sun will rise tomorrow. Why? Because it has risen for hundreds of millions of days. But you can't say that it's absolutely certainly will rise tomorrow. I have a great deal of confidence that it will rise tomorrow. But that doesn't mean that's absolute truth. There is no such thing as absolute truth. Equally true of every so-called, what people think are really hard scientific statements. Sir Karl Popper, famous philosopher, and particularly of scientific methodology, has his book called Conjectures and Refutations. And that's the right notion. Well, a scientific hypothesis is a conjecture. It's not a certainty. When I say, if you print a lot of money, you're going to have inflation, that's a conjecture. And I will continue to believe it until it's refuted by some evidence. But it's not an absolute truth. Now, how much confidence you have in a conjecture will depend on how often you have had evidence supporting it, but most important, how often it has had the opportunity to be refuted without having been refuted. So far as my personal experience is concerned, as I mentioned before, the New Deal was a great benefit to me. The New Deal gave me my first job after. The New Deal, as I say, may well have been harmful for the economy, but it was very beneficial for me. I got a job there, earned more money than I'd ever earned before, was able to work on things I was interested in, was able to write some articles that were published and establish a little bit of a scientific reputation. And again, after I left Washington in the mid-30s, I went back during the war, worked at the Treasury for 2 years from 41 to 43, worked as a mathematical statistician for 2 years from 43 to 45. So that I personally have been a beneficiary of governmental activity. So there's nothing personal in it whatsoever. It's entirely a result of what I believe is evidence and analysis, theory and analysis. The government, on the one hand, subsidizes the growers of tobacco. On the other hand, it spends the taxpayers' money to propagandize against smoking. The right hand and the left hand are offsetting one another. You're wasting resources. The government is spending the taxpayers' money to keep the price of milk at twice what it need be, a fluid milk, by milk marketing orders, dairy controls, farm price supports. At the same time, it's subsidizing food stamps and school lunches to enable people to pay that high price of milk. What it's spending with this hand is offsetting what it's doing with this hand. So most government expenditures are doing harm not because they're creating uncertainty, but because they're the equivalent of hiring people to dig holes and hiring other people to fill those holes up, because they're producing no economic product. Look, at the present time in the United States, governments at all levels are spending an amount of money equal to 43% of the national income. Is there a citizen of the United States who thinks he's getting 43% of his welfare from what the government is doing? People find it hard to believe that. Why? Because that government activity is so wasteful and so inefficient that the 50% or so that the private sector is providing, it accounts for 90% of his welfare, of the things he really uses and can use. Is a government, it isn't the fact that the government is wasting money on delivering mail inefficiently because it has a monopoly, is not producing uncertainty, it's just wasting the taxpayers' money. And you can go down the line. So that I don't want it to be thought that the main problem with government is that it produces uncertainty. That's the main problem with the monetary policy, but not with government in general. It's an interesting phenomenon that policy follows opinion, but only with about a 20-year lag. And the first example of that, of course, was a reaction to the Great Depression. Because during the whole of the 1920s and even earlier, intellectual opinion had been shifting towards socialism. In Britain, with the Fabian Society, in the United States, people don't realize that every economic platform, every economic plank of the Socialist Party platform of 1928 is now part of law. So intellectual opinion was shifting towards socialism. Public opinion was not of that thing. The Great Depression had the major effect it did because it made people, public opinion, accept that intellectual opinion and say, oh, we had a Great Depression because the private enterprise system failed on us, and we need to call government to our aid, and these intellectuals who were talking about having government play a larger role were really right. And so policy started to shift toward bigger and bigger government and more centralized government. But as it did so, people started getting disillusioned, and particularly small groups of intellectuals around the world started getting disillusioned. And intellectual opinion started to shift the other way. Let me give you a dramatic example. Ronald Reagan was preaching the same thing in 1964 when he spoke on behalf of Goldwater as he was preaching when he was elected president in 1980. He could not have been elected on that platform in 1964. He is the first only president in my lifetime who was elected not because he was saying what the people wanted to hear, but because the people had come around to wanting to hear what he was saying. He hadn't changed his opinions, but the public at large was getting fed up with what? With higher and higher taxes. With what? With inflation produced by government. With what? Increasing rules and regulations and governmental bureaucratic controls. So public opinion was beginning to share what had been happening in intellectual opinion. And once public opinion starts moving in that direction, with a lag of a decade or two, opinion will policy will follow. And that's why I was very optimistic that there was going to be a greater role for markets. More optimistic than was justified. We haven't achieved as much as I would have anticipated or expected. We have moved somewhat in that direction, but the greatest successes in that area have not come in the West. And indeed, well, I'll come back to that, but they've come in the East, obviously. The fall of the Berlin Wall, the end of communism in Poland and Czechoslovakia and Hungary is the most hopeful thing for human life, human policy, that has happened in my lifetime. It carries with it, however, problems for the United States. On the whole, I think it's been a bad thing for the United States because it's introduced complacency in the United States. We've been inclined to say, huh, look at this. These people, our system has been working and theirs hasn't. And therefore, what we've been doing, everything we've been doing must be right. I summarize this in the form of three propositions that are widely believed. Number one, socialism is a failure. Everybody believes that now. Number two, capitalism has been a success in enabling people to have a higher level of income and a higher degree of freedom. Everybody believes that. Proposition number three, therefore, the United States needs more socialism. Hard to render that consistent with the first two propositions, and yet it's what people believe. You don't hear talk in Washington about having more capitalism. You hear talk in Washington about how we need to have more government spending on schools. We need to have a stricter enforcement of drug prohibition. We need to have a child care methods. We need to have the government pass Clean Air Acts. But if they were really taking the lessons of what's happened in Eastern Europe, they would be saying, or the people would be requiring their representatives in Washington to say, we should abolish Amtrak, we should get rid of farm subsidies, we should eliminate tariffs, we should cut the government down to size. But that's not what anybody is saying, although that's the lesson that is taught. Problems in the United States are exactly the same as the problems with the Soviet Union, with Poland and the others. The difference is that they were 100% socialist and we're only 50% socialist. But just as their 100% socialism produced problems that was beyond belief, every major problem in the United States, in my opinion, is coming from the 50% of our society that's socialist. I've mentioned education, which I think is, people talk about problems like budget deficits, like foreign trade deficits and so on. Those aren't the real problems of the United States. The real problems of the United States are in education, which is disgraceful. We are spending more money on education per capita than any other country in the world, and we are getting poorer results. And we need to privatize it. The second major problem in the United States arises out of the attempt to prohibit the use of drugs. I have estimated that there are 10,000 deaths a year through homicides because of the attempt to enforce drug prohibition. That's not a number pulled out of the sky. It's based on a comparison of the rate of homicides during the 50s when there was little attempt to enforce drug prohibition, and the rate of homicide during the 80s, after you had first the drug war declared by Nixon, and then by each successive president since then. Drugs are a terrible curse. I'm not suggesting that they're a good thing or anything, but far more harm is being done by trying to, by making them illegal than good. Because we are creating, we are destroying our inner cities. We're destroying the life of people. We're killing people because of the wars being fought by the drugs. Because why? Because we create such enormous profit opportunities which would otherwise not exist. And more than that, I find it hard how anybody can justify the United States destroying a country like Colombia in Latin America because we cannot enforce our own laws. If we could enforce our own laws, there'd be no problem in Colombia. But we can't enforce them. And so we destroy Colombia. How can you justify that? It's disgraceful. And we can go on and on and on with that. But there's no question in my mind that far more harm than good is being done. And that you would have less drug addiction and less harm from drug addiction in a world in which it was decriminalized than in the present world. We discovered, we went through this once with prohibition in the 1920s and 30s. Why do we have to go through it again? Because people seem not to be able to learn from experience. That's another problem, and that's traceable to government. The savings and loan debacle, traceable to government, obviously. It was the inflation of the 70s, plus a set of rules and regulations under which the government said to the savings and loans, we'll play heads you win, tails I lose. So that. Now, we have a problem of infrastructure. It's a fascinating thing. In the 1930s, out here in San Francisco, they were able to build the Golden Gate Bridge and the Bay Bridge. People say, we couldn't afford to do that now. But we're three times as wealthy now as we were then. How come we could afford to do it then? The answer is because the government wasn't doing all the other things that it has no business doing. And you could go down the line. So the problems we have are primarily problems created by ourselves, by that socialist sector, of exactly the same character as the problems created in Eastern Europe by a 100% socialist sector. And that's why when I was in Poland not a few months ago and I gave a talk there, the title of my talk was why the United States is not the right model for Poland. What the right model for Poland is the United States 100 years ago, or Hong Kong before the Chinese started taking it over more recently. It is a right model that we can afford all the nonsense and the harm that government is doing because we had 100 years of a real free market on which to build up our wealth, and therefore we're wealthy enough to afford to waste half of our product. But Poland isn't wealthy enough to do that. Czechoslovakia isn't wealthy enough to do that. If you want to see the power of institutions, just look at how it is that 30 years of socialism can convert Czechoslovakia from one of the wealthiest countries in the world, which it was in the 1930s. It was had higher income than Britain. It was on a level with the United States. 30 or 40 years of socialism can convert Czechoslovakia from one of the wealthiest countries in the world to a third world country. 40 years of socialism can produce a West and East Germany coming from the same background, the same source, starting from the same point, which are as wide apart as they are. And if we keep on with our 50% socialism and make it 60 and 70, it'll do the same, have the same destructive effects in this country. If you look back, the period of the 1870 to 1914, the period of the greatest amount of private charitable activity in the history of the world. Carnegie libraries, private hospitals. It's a very interesting exercise to go down and look in the Wall Street, in the World Almanac, at the list of nonprofit institutions and when they were founded. Boy Scouts, Red Cross, you go down all of the list. Those nonprofit institutions which are devoted to helping people were all founded in the 19th century, early 20th century. The ones that were founded after 1920, and particularly after the 1930s, were primarily professional organizations, associations devoted to special interests. Very few organizations devoted to helping people, like the Salvation Army or the Red Cross or what I've described before, are founded after that. Government has taken over responsibility for it. People say, why should I have to contribute to that? The government is doing that. I'm paying tax money. So what's happened? It's not that people have become less willing to make voluntary grants, but they've gone in a different direction. People now give money to museums, to art institutes, to symphony orchestras, and so on, but they don't give money to help the poor, because that's the government's taking over that function. Whereas in the, before 1914, a much larger fraction of all donations were of that kind and were of a personal kind in which people took a personal interest. There's an enormous amount of voluntary activity going on in this country, charitable, but some of it is co-opted by the government, is essentially a contribution to the governmental functions, like assisting in the government schools and the inefficient government schools. And much of it goes into the kinds of other activities I've described, which really have a wholly different purpose, cultural as opposed to eleemosynary. Economics is one discipline among many. I'm not saying every young man, there isn't room for everybody in economics. Some people will find they're interested in economics. Some people are interested in physics. Some people are interested in mathematics. The important thing is for people to try to find an activity in which, as I said before, they are going to get paid for doing something they enjoy doing. They ought to try to find an activity in which they want to work overtime. If they can learn more about the way the world works, they can contribute to forming a public opinion which will be in favor of things that will help the society instead of hurt it. It's very simple. Economists have regarded as one of their main functions over more than 200 years to try to persuade the people that free trade is better than protectionism. They have never succeeded. But yet, if they had not been doing that, I'm sure we'd have a lot more protectionism than we do now. I sound like one of these presidents of the Federal Reserve System, and I don't like that. But I think it is true that we're not going to succeed. We're going to preach. We're going to preach on the basis of what we believe to be real evidence. 99% of the economists believe in free trade. And there's very little disagreement on that. That's why I chose that. And we'll have a little effect. But that little effect will be, we'll pay our salaries and will more than compensate society for having provided us with food and clothing and housing and a little bit of extras for luxuries. You develop your own capacities. You do what you want to do. Don't do anything because you think it's going to help other people. Because you may be wrong. How the devil do you know what's good for other people? But you know what's good for you. You know what you really enjoy doing. You know what your talents are and what your qualities are. You develop your own qualities and your own talents, and the sum of a lot of people doing that will be a beautiful society. And don't waste your efforts on trying to tell other people what's good for them. What fascinates me so about economic system is that the fundamental principles are so simple. You feel as if anybody can learn in 2 days the basic fundamentals of economics. They're very simple. The elementary principles of economics are trivial. People can spend their own money better than they can spend any more carefully than they'll spend anybody else's. Buy low, sell high, go down. The principles are very simple. And yet, it seems to be so hard for people to understand them. And people so often get them wrong. And the major reason they do And this is what is really fascinating, is that almost always what's true for the individual is the opposite of what's true for everybody put together. You go down the street and you buy some strawberries. You think you can buy as many strawberries as you want at the price that's posted, and you're right. But let's suppose everybody in the country tried to buy more strawberries. There wouldn't be any more strawberries. The total quantity of strawberries is fixed, the price would have to go up. So from the point of view of the individual, the quantity is variable and the price is fixed. For everybody together, the quantity is fixed and the price is variable. And what's true for strawberries is true for almost everything you can think of. And that's why, in my opinion, ordinary people are so subject to economic fallacies, because they tend to extrapolate from what's true for them as an individual for what's true for everybody. And almost always that's a wrong extrapolation. Oh, it's human behavior, but it's not psychology. And the reason it's not is because psychology is concerned with the individual. Economics is concerned with a collection of people. And that's why it's not psychology. It's because it's average behavior that we're looking at, whereas the psychologist is looking at the individual. And the aberrations that will be of most interest to the psychologist will average out from the point of view of the economist. So it's not about psychology. I wrote and talked and objected strenuously to the political policies that General Pinochet was following, but he was following the correct economic policies. And Chile is today the healthiest country in Latin America, and today it's also a democratic country, and the dictatorship has been overthrown, and it's been overthrown because they followed the right economic policies. Pinochet didn't realize it, but he was sowing the seeds of his own destruction. The real miracle in Chile is that a dictatorship was willing to follow good economic policies. Most dictatorships are not willing to do that, and the reason is very simple. Good economic policies come from the bottom up. The consumers, the individual workers, are the people who determine what happens. But a dictatorship is from the top down. And top down people don't want to accept bottom up policies. And that's why I wrote in Newsweek back at that time contemporaneously that the real miracle in Chile was that Pinochet was willing to follow good economic policies. Good economic policies will establish conditions that will permit political freedom. But political freedom will sometimes lead to the destruction of the economic policies. Just as in the United States, the good economic policies are a good economic system, not the policies, the institutions. The institutions are private property, which is the essence, and freedom to trade and freedom to buy and sell, created the conditions which supported political freedom in the United States throughout its history. But political freedom in the United States has now been producing the conditions which over the last 50 years destroyed much of the economic system, took over half of it. So that time and again, just as people are suicidal in their impulses, just as business enterprises are suicidal in their impulses, they favor government policies like tariffs and subsidies, which will destroy the very basis of their existence. And they are suicidal. So the relationship between, I must say, this is one area in which I have changed my views drastically over the years. I used to say that economic freedom is a necessary but not a sufficient condition for political freedom. That's a true statement. But I also used to believe that economic freedom and political freedom went together in the sense that political freedom contributed to economic freedom and vice versa. I no longer believe that. I believe there's a very strong tendency that has to be fought all the time for political freedom to lead to the destruction of economic freedom. Now, let me emphasize, I believe very strongly in freedom, both political and economic. But I think you have to be more sophisticated. You have economic freedom, and you have human freedom, and you can have human freedom without political freedom. And then you have political freedom in the sense in which we mean it, that people can vote for their own leaders. Hong Kong is a marvelous case in point. no political freedom whatsoever, but yet the most extensive human freedom. Probably no place on earth where people were freer to speak, to write, to talk, to say anything they wanted before the Chinese took over from the British. Pure accident because of the accidental colonial people who were appointed to govern. So you can have human freedom without political freedom. You can have economic freedom without political freedom. But you cannot have political freedom without a large measure of economic freedom.